Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Bombay Chamber of Commerce and Industry, let me welcome you to the 184th Annual General Meeting. I am Shruti Rathod, your host for today. I have the privilege to mention that our guest of honor, Dr. Swati Piramal, Vice Chairperson, Piramal Group, have joined the session. To begin with the proceedings, may I now invite Mr. Sandeep Khosla, Director General, to deliver the welcome and introductory remarks.
Thank you, Shruti. The minister just informed us that he is on a call. Minister's office just informed us that he's on a call. He'll join us shortly. So we will start the session and while we await his presence. So Dr. Swati Piramal, Vice Chairperson, Piramal Group, Mr. Partha Sarthi, Mr. Sudhir Kaparia, Ms. Anjali Bansal, past presidents, member of the Bombay Chamber Board, Councillor Co-op, members of the press, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 184th Annual General Meeting of the Bombay Chamber of Commerce and Industry, which, as most of you know, is the oldest chamber of commerce and industry in India. The chamber, which has been providing continuous and unstinting service to its esteemed members in its history of 183 years, is organizing its annual general meeting virtually for the first time due to the unforeseen pandemic caused by COVID-19. Since Mr. Partha Sarthi will be addressing us on the chamber's achievements during the year gone by, and Mr. Sudhir Kaparia will be underlining the focus areas going forward, I will briefly touch upon some ongoing initiatives taken by the chamber, keeping in view the benefits of our member community, both the large corporates and the MSMEs, which constitute around 60% of our membership. In line with its theme, Corporates for Change, the chamber took the initiative of issuance of digital certificate of origin for the benefit of its member exporters. This will not only help our members, but exporters throughout the country who can avail the benefit of our online certificate of origin services. To update our members, the chamber has been regularly hosting on its website every notification and circular issued by both the central and the state governments. During this period, the chamber has been conducting webinars on various topics covering areas such as legal, taxation, sustainability, banking, finance, media, films, and many, many more. Our labor advisory department is very active and has been regularly supporting members by providing opinion advisory to members on recent issues. Bombay Chamber has appealed to its members to contribute towards the cause of COVID-19 situation. It's a matter of pride that our members generally contributed an amount of 61.5 lakh, both in cash and kind. The chamber utilized this to help 6 government and municipal hospitals. There's the JJ Hospital, Sion Hospital, Thane Municipal Hospital, Washi Municipal Hospital, and a couple of others, with much needed equipment, medicines, and consumables. I would like to take this opportunity to stress upon one of the major initiatives, namely the Center for Mediation and Conciliation, that has been working tirelessly to spread awareness about mediation to resolve commercial disputes. We believe that justice should not be put on hold. Hence, in order to overcome the lockdown, our mediation wing has provided an infrastructure for remote mediation and online mediation, which is already seeing successful conclusion of cases. Before I conclude, I would like to welcome each one of you once again and express my sincere thanks to all members for their continued support to the initiatives and activities of the chamber. Thank you, and over to you, Shruti.
Thank you, sir. It is an honor that we are a part of the 184th AGM of the Chamber. To brief us on the achievements of the Chamber during the preceding year under his leadership, may I now request Mr. V.S. Partha Sarthi, President, Bombay Chamber, President, Mobility Services Sector, Mahindra Group, and member of the Group Executive Board, Mahindra & Mahindra Limited, to deliver the presidential address.
I want to start by saying the Honorable Minister of Railways, of Commerce and Industry, Ms. Piyush Goyal, our chief guest. He is today, right now, as Sangam happens, Saraswati is always, you know, it says, Lup Trup mein pai jati hai. It's always present in his absence. So, absentia. So, I'm sure the chief guest will join us very soon. A warm welcome to him as and when he joins, and a warm welcome to him as he as he is right now in the Sangam stage. The guest of honor, Ms. Swati Piramal, Vice President, Mr. Sudhir Kapadia, President-elect, Ms. Anjali Bansal, Senior Vice President-elect, Mr. Sandeep Khosla, DG, and colleagues from Managing Committee of the Chambers and fellow members of the Chambers, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and thank you for taking the time to be with us today. Let me first once again welcome you and convey my deep gratitude to all of you for supporting me and the Chamber in taking forward the Chamber's legacy. All of us are aware about the rich legacy of Bombay Chamber, its 184 years history and its contribution to the world of business and society at large. We may say that BCCI acted as a catalyst for corporates to pool resources in driving positive changes. In the vast ocean of BCCI's history, my presidentship of last year is but a drop, but an enriching one for me. Today may be a good day to reflect upon the last year's journey. The best way to predict the future is to create it. So said Peter Drucker, the management guru. That's what runs through as the message of the presidentship, and it carries on all your behalf. The baton now passes, but the relevance of the message remains. The mission statement I set out have been the compass for all our activity, and while the chamber conducted more than 100 events, I shall highlight to you only a few, just so that it underscores how the journey was focused on the mission statement. Before we go into specific, a minute on the approach that we followed. We relied on listening before designing. We executed with an ear to the ground. I'm just pausing in case. Should I continue, Sandeep? I just welcomed you, Honorable Minister, just now. Yeah. And I said that I see you as the Sangam, Saraswati. Now I see you as Ganga and Jamuna as well. Okay. So welcome, sir. And I will continue with my speech so that I don't take more time. And I will finish this in the next 5-7 minutes so that then I can welcome you. Okay, so just before I go into specifics, I'm continuing with the speech. A minute on the approach that we followed. We relied on listening before designing. We executed with an ear to the ground. And post-delivery listened again to refine our learning. We listened to our constituents, our stakeholders and functionaries. We followed the outside-in perspective by inviting them to our board meeting. You may recall the mission statement has themes of corporates for change, which rests on four elements: ease of doing business, sustainable change, fempower, and Mumbai 4.0. I have the pleasure of walking you through certain key initiatives implemented under each of these elements. Ease of doing business is a mantra advocated by most, but what sets us apart is making it compatible to values and responsibilities. This was reflected in our Frontiers for Corporate Governance program. We had the privilege of senior industry leaders and compliance professionals as participants and guidance from veterans like Mr. Damodaran, ex-chairman of SEBI. The message delivered was clear, and it was the absolute need for and adherence to governance. The thought leadership of Chamber in this domain was exemplified in the Vision 2025 document created by us. The Chamber walks the talk and facilitates ease of doing business by offering mediation, arbitration, legal advisory, certificate of origin, amongst others. Ease of doing business is also our theme in our advocacy efforts, whether as a part of budget submission or COVID-19 situation or as recommendation on monetary policy. We also met regulatory authorities such as RBI and SEBI. The Chamber has undertaken numerous programs such as Understandable Change. One of the programs was Corporates for Change Conclave. The conclave was conducted in collaboration with OECD. OECD chose BCCI to conduct a preview of its report on India, CSR and philanthropy. The conclave showcased the impactful collaboration in the industry so that major societal issues are addressed. Eminent leaders like Vikram Mehta appealed to the industry to build the movement on sustainable change. The conclave laid the foundation of transplanting the corporates for change and sustainable change agenda from strategic boardrooms to operations of company. ESOP, I'm sure, will now be named employee social options and not stock options. OECD was impressed with the work which all of us are doing, and I'm glad to inform you that as I was appointed as the co-chair of OECD Mnet Working Group for Business and Sustainability. Young Bombay Forum of BCCI appreciated the work done by Nani Kali by supporting education and underprivileged school students. We firmly believe that sustainability is as important in rural area as it is in urban area. Our agri conference was pivoted on water. What is interesting is that the conference showcased how the water issue can be managed sustainably for India with innovation and enterprise. I am glad to inform you that recently UN Habitat, a United States organization, chose BCCI for holding the conference regarding urban recovery. The chamber recognizes that as a nation, we need to encourage evolution of ecology to tap the talent available with women workforce. We also appreciate the need and benefit of diversity and now intend to call the FemPower initiative as FemPower Plus. As a first step, we carried out study on talent available at homes. We also developed a framework for carrying out a joint work with IFC. The work has the potential to evolve a model replicable in other cities in India and ultimately at global level. We also invited veterans as well as young professional and entrepreneur women at our public events as well as board meeting to get inspired from them and also to learn. This was done in addition to several training programs specifically meant for women. Now let's come to our home city, Amchi Mumbai. Mumbai 4.0 remains a critical element for our city-based chamber. Mumbai began its journey as a port and then evolved into industrial center and moved into service sectors like banking, insurance, advertisements, finance, etc. We are now shifting towards knowledge economy based on AI, machine learning, etc. Mumbai must remain relevant and must remain a thriving city. It also needs to become a place to live in, best place to live in. In order to do that, what we did is we connected with students from municipal schools who expressed that vision for the city in beautiful paintings, which culminated in Mumbai of My Dream, a coffee table book which vividly depicts the expectation and hope of the next generation. We also connected with industry and academic leaders like Uday Kotak and Rama Bijapurkar. Significant ideas were generated for building City of My Dreams, which everybody could be proud of. We also connected with international delegation in the course of last year. We advocated a national asset renewal program for renewing assets of national importance and rehabilitating companies through a socially funded and entrepreneurially driven program. Whilst I could go on and on to discuss various programs, I would like to take this opportunity to mention special moments in this journey. These are having my mentor Deepak Parekh preside over when I took presidentship, Nani Kali sharing their dreams on foundation day through a performance, and the chamber coming together to support and aid municipal hospital during the pandemic. I'm sure we could have achieved much more if you wouldn't have lost 3 to 4 months this year due to COVID-19. But at the same time, I'm delighted that we are able to witness the Mumbai spirit yet again shining like a beacon during the troubled times. The setting we have today is a brave new world, as Shakespeare would call it, a world that's changing, and the cliched new normal is itself walking the thin line of the abnormal. While many of us are too bewildered to make meaning of this extraordinary situation, BCCI needs to be that citizen of the brave new world, reimagining its resources and for facing a world of true paradigm. Before I end, I must once again thank the ex-DG, the current DG, BCCI Secretariat. We achieved a lot during this period with their support and effort. I also thank my fellow board members, past president, committee members, chairpersons, and all contributors in this journey. I would also like to take the opportunity to wish the newly elected board and offer my best wishes. As we move forward, these initiatives as long-term goals, we will move far ahead and make this chamber with a difference, with a mission, and with dynamism. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed people can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. Margaret Mead said this. I'm sure the journey will continue and we'll scale higher and higher peaks. Thank you, Bombay Chambers, for allowing me this opportunity to navigate a deeply admired and venerated institute. Thank you, and back to Shruti.
Thank you, sir. Requesting members to please post their questions in the Q&A box. It's now time for the eagerly awaited keynote address by our chief guest, Shri Piyush Goyal, Honorable Minister, Ministry of Commerce and Industry and Railways. Shri Piyush Goyal is the Minister of Railways and Minister of Commerce and Industry for the Government of India. He is a member of the upper house of the Parliament of India, Rajya Sabha, and the Deputy Leader of the Rajya Sabha. He was earlier the Minister of Railways and Coal. He has also held additional charge of Minister of Finance and Corporate Affairs twice in 2018 and 19. Earlier, he was Minister of State for Power, Coal, New and Renewable Energy and Mines. Shri Goyal's tenure has seen Indian Railways achieve its best ever safety record in 2018 and 19. This was achieved through holistic measures such as elimination of unmanned level crossings from the broad gauge network, production of safer coaches, etc. Additionally, Shri Goyal oversaw the launch of the first indigenous semi-high-speed train, Vande Bharat Express, between Delhi and Varanasi. The power, coal, and new and renewable energy ministries led transformational changes in India's power sector, including the fast tracking of electrification of the nearly 18,000 unelectrified villages in some of the remotest and inaccessible parts of the country, the rollout of the most comprehensive power sector reform ever, Uday, the success of the world's largest LED bulb distribution program, Ujala, for energy efficiency. Other achievements include the elimination of coal shortages to improve the energy security of India and successful conduct of transparent e-auctions of coal blocks. He also received the fourth annual Carnot Prize in 2018, recognizing the path-breaking transformations in India's energy sector. During his 35-year-long political career, Shri Goyal has held several important positions at different levels in the world's largest political party, the Bharatiya Janata Party, and is in its national executive. He has been the national treasurer of the party. In the 2019 Indian general elections, he was a member of the manifesto and publicity committees. He also headed the BJP's Information Communication Campaign Committee for the Indian general elections 2014. Shri Goyal has had a brilliant academic record and all India second rank holder, chartered accountant, and second rank holder in law in Mumbai University. He was a well-known investment banker and has advised top corporates on management strategy and growth. He also served on the board of India's largest commercial bank, the State Bank of India and Bank of Baroda. He was also nominated by the Government of India to the task force for interlinking of rivers in 2002. May I request Sri Goel to deliver his keynote address?
Thank you very much, Mr. V.S. Parthasarathy, President of the Bombay Chamber of Commerce. Dr. Swati Piramal, Mr. Sudhir Kapadia, Mr. Sandeep Khosla, several other friends that I see on the call, and many whom I cannot see because of the new way that we're going to work in the post-COVID world. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, Ms. Rathod, for your kind introduction. The last 4 months have seen immense change in all our lives. I would much rather have been in my own hometown, my own home city of Mumbai, to attend your annual general meeting rather than doing it over the video. But as times change, so do we. As circumstances come before us, we adapt to those circumstances, but we don't give up. And I think that's the resilience that the people of India, that trade, business, commerce, industry across India has demonstrated in the last few months. And the confidence of a nation of 130 crore people that we will overcome this crisis also and work together towards converting this crisis into an opportunity. In fact, we have moved from the lockdown phase largely to unlock two now. At the city or state level, containment zones still have certain restrictions. We still don't have the familiar Mumbai locals back on track fully. But there are certain challenges, certain concerns, certain health priorities, which we'll all have to live with for some more time. I was reading this morning's papers where TCS has spoken about 25% only working in the offices, the rest moving towards work from home, maybe in the next 3 or 4 years, 5 years. So there's been huge suffering due to COVID. There's been a lot of difficulties businesses have faced, the common man has faced. We have all had challenges which we have grappled with in the last few days. But I must say and acknowledge the huge role that all the chambers of commerce, all industry captains, leaders from different sections of society have played in helping the country work together to overcome this pandemic, this global pandemic, something that was most unexpected, something that came very suddenly onto us, and something which has affected all our lives very, very deeply. Of course, our very dear Amitabh Bachchan and his family also have been affected with COVID. But I must say, he's a person who has, for the last 4 months, continuously engaged with the people at large. He has continuously been giving out very good health advisories and messages to the people at large. He has always motivated our fellow countrymen not to fight with the COVID patient, but to fight with the disease. I don't know if any of you have seen that video clipping of his. It's beautiful. It's very, very touching, where he says that let's not shun the COVID patient. Let's work towards fighting against COVID, the illness, the pandemic, not against somebody who's affected by COVID. And I think by and large, the nation has really responded to the Honorable Prime Minister's appeals from time to time in terms of the lockdown first in terms of precautions like social distancing, wearing of masks whenever we are in public, ensuring safety, hygiene, high qualities of cleanliness. And to my mind, despite supporting 17% of the world population, we have been able to in good measure, respond in a very, very organized and mature manner to this grave health crisis. In fact, the recovery level in India has now crossed 62%. In terms of number of deaths, when compared to the whole world, we are still at very, very reasonable levels. Our immunity levels as a nation are demonstrated to be far better, more resilient than many other, even more advanced and developed economies. And using the lockdown phase of about 10 weeks or so, this country has truly demonstrated, and I must acknowledge and thank all of India's industry for coming forward proactively to make India self-sufficient in a variety of ways to make India ready to fight this pandemic. In fact, I remember when the lockdown was announced, we had barely 4 centers where COVID testing could happen. We could probably do 2,500 in a single day. Today, COVID testing is happening at more than 1,000 centers all over the country, authorized centers. And our testing has ramped up 100 times. We have a capacity now to do 300,000. I remember when the lockdown was announced, the biggest concern was availability of personal protective equipment, PPEs, masks, and such other equipment like ventilators, adequate supply of oxygen, which could have been required in very large numbers. All of these issues, including the very few ICU beds or COVID isolation centers available with the country, were challenges which had prompted several international observers and pundits to suggest that India would be one of the worst affected countries. I think we have used this time to start producing PPEs in India. We are not only self-sufficient, we started exporting PPEs now. We have enough and more mask making in India. We have sufficient isolation wards for COVID care. We have sufficient ICU wards, beds available across the country. Railways in their own small way have also contributed to ensuring that in the remotest corners, should we need isolation beds or COVID beds, the railways can provide that facility. And I think all in all, as the country prepared itself to fight this pandemic, so did we also start unlocking the nation. And save and except again, the containment zones, I think there's more and more realization that we'll have to get back to normal. Maintaining all the strict health protocols or advisories that the center or the state government has been issuing from time to time, I think it's time we all took some bold initiatives and got back the wheels of the economy and get our growth back on track. In fact, if you see any statistic, in Unlock 2, the country is fast moving towards the previous year levels in terms of electricity consumption, in terms of the freight moved in the railways. I mean, last month, June, the railways loading of freight was at 93% level of June 2019. Electricity, I'm told, is upwards of 90% levels, which have been restored in the economy. I was checking with the cement industry yesterday. I believe the cement industry also is back to the pre-COVID level of about 65%, which is usually the level at which it works in a pre-monsoon period. Different indicators suggest exports, the June export number was at about 88% of June 19 level. So it very clearly is demonstrating that we are moving very rapidly towards a reasonable level of operation. We'll of course have certain sectors like tourism, like hospitality, aviation, also passenger travel on railways and public transport, which will remain a challenge for some more time. But I'm sure as we work collectively towards bringing in normalcy and towards preparing or finding a cure and a vaccine for this disease, we will all get more and more to normal way of working. Of course, nobody can deny that it's almost going to be a new world that we will all be stepping into. Just like we had BC and AC, I read somebody had coined this term that the before COVID and after COVID world are going to be significantly different. And be it the chambers of commerce, be it industry, manufacturing, services, be it government, I think we are all preparing ourselves for the post-COVID world. But I tell you, huge good can come out of it if we learn our lessons well. One good is my own efficiency I found is 3 times better than what it ever was before. And if the previous VC allows you to exit on time and a couple of speakers don't add on just 2 more questions or 1 more question, then I'm actually finding I can be in reasonable time for my engagements rather than the earlier days when people would fly down from all over the country for 1 meeting in Delhi. In the middle of almost preparing for that meeting, something more urgent would come up and you would have tons of people waiting for you to show up. You would have meetings stretching long because there's a lot of social courtesies. Now I buy my own water, I buy my own cup of tea. You don't have to even dedicate budgets for all of that. Less social conversations, not always good, but more business, more action, more outcome, more output, and effective implementation. That's going to be the mantra in the next few months and years. And to bring the economy back on track for fast-paced growth in a sustained manner, the Honorable Prime Minister has very rightly given us a 5-I mantra: intent, inclusion, investment, infrastructure, and innovation. I think there can be no better description of what we all need to do, not only to bring the economy back on track, but to actually take the country back to its goal of a $5 trillion economy. We may have lost some time, but we've not lost the spirit, the enthusiasm. And I believe the only way out of this crisis is going to be growth, is going to be rapid growth, is going to be a collective effort. But that effort not only should be our good intent, but should also care for the less privileged sections of society. That's the inclusion that the Prime Minister talks about, the MSMEs, small entrepreneurs, small shopkeepers. It'll also have to have a lot of engagement in terms of private capital, supplementing government's own efforts on investment and infrastructure. We'll have to look at engaging with the rest of the world to get capital and to open up our market and open their markets for our products. When we talk of investment, when we talk of infrastructure, we are not looking at only what we can do within the country. we are looking at greater global engagement. And after all, Atmanirbhar Bharat is not about closing India's doors. It's about opening India's doors. It's about greater global engagement, a larger role for our Indian entrepreneurs, businesses, and our youngsters and our stakeholders to become part of resilient global supply chains. It's about improving our quality of production, achieving higher economies of scale, greater production capacities, so that we not only meet India's needs, but we also meet global demand, but at competitive prices and with quality products. And therefore, the last I, innovation becomes important. After all, if you see the developed world, most developed countries have succeeded on the back of new technology, engagement with newer ways of doing work, innovating not only products and services, but also their own processes. And that's what I think chambers such as yours and government can do in partnership, work together to give a significant boost to the nation's collective effort to bring back growth, to bring back jobs, to bring back a self-resilient and confident country, engaging with the rest of the world from a position of strength, not weakness, but in fact expanding that engagement, not closing our doors, not restricting our own engagement with the rest of the world. I personally believe the kind of reforms that the Honorable Prime Minister has announced through Atmanirbhar Bharat are very, very well crafted, not only for the short-term relief that is sought to be given in several ways, but for a more sustained long-term future for the Indian economy and for a better future for our children, a better future for the 130 crore Indians in the length and breadth of the country. It'll need a multi-pronged approach towards ease of doing business, towards reducing the cost of doing business. I'm very much seized of the fact that we'll have to look at plug-and-play infrastructure. We'll have to look at making it easier to interact with government online through real simplified processes. Maybe a single window, but which is a genuine single window, not a window which opens to 50 other doors behind it. We'll have to look at making affordable finance available to businesses. We'll have to look at long-term finance being available for infrastructure and manufacturing. As Railway Minister, I'm conscious goods have to move fast. Goods have to move at lower prices. The fast part, we have been working the last 3-4 months of the lockdown to improve our freight speeds. And I'm happy to share with you, I monitor it on a daily basis. But yesterday, for example, I'll quote exact numbers so I don't make any mistake. Yesterday, the Indian Railways, on July 12th data I'm giving you, the speed of our freight trains was 95% more than it was on 12th July 2019. So our average freight train speed 1 year ago on the same day yesterday was 23.38 kilometers per hour. Yesterday it was 45.54 kilometers per hour. We are actually reaching goods in half the time it used to take in the pre-COVID days. While I appreciate we've been able to do this largely because a lot of the passenger trains are not working, but going forward, we are trying to institutionalize this so that we don't slip up again, even as we reinstate the passenger traffic. And freight continues to get that preeminent position so that goods can move faster, provide more paths so that our services to our passengers can be better and we can move much greater degree of freight to bring down the cost of railway freight. Similarly, yesterday we loaded 92% of what we had loaded 1 year ago on the same day. I'm only trying to share with you that all of us in our own small way are trying to see how we can improve using this crisis, using this problem, converting it into an opportunity and preparing ourselves to support industry, to support businesses, to become more cost competitive, to expand in terms of size and scale and reach, and truly become global in nature. In fact, massive cut in corporate taxes, significant amendments in company law to decriminalize a number of the aspects of the administration of company law, concerted actions taken to address domestic constraints, maybe in the form of adequate liquidity being available, bringing down cost of credit to more affordable levels, trade facilitation through digitalization, greater degree of transparency in all our actions of the government, trying to address GST issues, particularly the inverted duty issue on import duties and GST, capacity building through skilling, better logistics, as I just mentioned. All of these are issues that we have been grappling with for several years now. While a lot of effort was made in earlier years, you know, our own ease of doing business indices have improved significantly. And our rank is currently at around 62 or 63 against 142, 62, I think, against 142 several years ago. Now, all of these are steps that the government has consistently been taking. We want to be a preferred trading partner in the global economy. We want to work more and more with transparent, rule-based, and like-minded countries to promote international trade, for which we are pursuing greater degree of engagement with several countries and several geographies. We are keen that our industries become a key part of resilient global value chains. And I can assure you the government's full support in all the good work that all of you are doing. Bombay Chamber at one point of time was famous for stopping international engagement. I'm not trying to remind you of those days, but I think now in the new world, the Bombay Chamber has a much greater responsibility to strengthen domestic industry, to make us really vibrant, to help us achieve scale and competitiveness, so that we can engage with the world from a position of strength and competitiveness, not dependent on the clutches of government, but standing on our own feet as a confident business, as a confident sector, which can provide to the rest of the world. We also appreciate that every country cannot be competitive in everything, and we will need to import certain products where we may have certain difficulties. But the effort should be to move more and more towards self-reliance. COVID has taught us a big lesson. Overdependence can cause you a lot of difficulties in the time of stress. And God forbid, there's any other similar challenge before the rest of the world. I think next time around, India will be far, far better prepared, far, far more confident to face any such crisis. In our own way, we have been identifying sectors where import substitution or export potential is there in big measure. And I'm sure we can all work together to make this happen. 12 priority sectors that we have identified and worked very actively so far are food processing, organic farming, iron and steel, aluminium and copper, agrochemicals, electronics, industrial machinery, furniture, leather and footwear, auto parts, textiles, and several other such initiatives, marine products, for example, huge potential in marine products. Now we are looking at more sectors, and I would urge all of you also to look at what new sectors we can look to really promote Indian manufacturing, just like we have done for electronics, for medical devices, or for API and KSMs. I would urge the chamber also to help us in our designing of ease of doing business, the single window framework that we are trying to create, and come up with robust mechanisms which are transparent, simple to operate, yet don't leave scope for misuse. I was in an earlier session with a particular industry was asking for certain concessions. But then when I pointed to them out what those concessions could lead to in terms of leakages in the system, in terms of the truant businessman or business person misusing the system, we could all realize that how important it is to have simplicity, yet robust self-regulation. And we have Sudhir Bhai over here, who's himself a tax expert. We have industry leaders. Partha, your colleague, Pawan Goenka, has been really supporting us in our work for Atmanirbhar Bharat and identifying and working with these sectors. So I'm sure we can trust the Bombay Chamber to play a very, very important role, because the prosperity of the nation is a shared responsibility of all of us. It cannot be left only to the government. In fact, sectors where you have kept government out of your head have largely been more successful than sectors where government has interfered. And IT industry is a living example of that. So let us see how we can reduce officialdom. Let us see how we can get government out of your businesses, yet ensure that we have an orderly way of working. We expect everybody to contribute to this effort that the Honorable Prime Minister has laid before this nation. The Atmanirbhar Bharat is a strong India, is a resilient India, is a confident India, in which trade bodies have a very important role to play as partners in India's growth story. Let us work together. Let us work together in the spirit of oneness and togetherness. My best wishes to the new team. My best wishes for the year ahead of you. This is your 184th annual general meeting. Truly a remarkable milestone. One of the oldest chambers, but I know for sure, age has only made you wiser. Age has only brought more sheen to your glamour. And I have no doubt that going forward, Bombay Chamber will continue to serve industry, business, yet also keep the last man at the bottom of the pyramid in our focus as being the person for whom we all exist. My best wishes to you, Partha, and your team. My best wishes to all the participants in this annual general meeting. May you all stay safe. May you all get well soon, stay healthy. And I want to add a small word, my best wishes that Mr. Amitabh Bachchan and his family, who are all our dear Mumbaikars, somebody we look up to as icons, somebody who have played a very proactive role in the last 4 months during COVID to keep the morale of the nation high. I don't know if you've seen that small clipping of his where he's talking, let's fight the disease, not the patient. And I think he really has been a model inspiration for all of us. We all pray for his early recovery, good health. We hope he gets well soon, goes back home, and continues to serve, along with his family, continues to serve the nation. My best wishes to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Hello.
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah. May I request Ms. Anjali Bansal, Senior Vice President, Bombay Chamber, to moderate the question and answer section.
Thanks so much for joining
sorry,
us.
Yes, Anjali.
No,
yeah, go.
I wouldn't have, I think we have, what you have planned is much beyond the time that the office had allocated. But if there are one or two quick ones that you have, I've otherwise been reading the chat box and trying to respond in my conversation.
Sure.
But
so
I can't
comment us a couple of quick questions.
Queries like, are we going to increase import duty on a product or no and stuff like that? That's not possible for me to respond.
And we wouldn't request you to respond to such specific things. So first of all, thank you so much for joining us today and taking the time. We are encouraged and energized by your very positive address. Also the message of innovation, resilience, and Atmanirbhar, which means not inward looking, but actually resilient and strong to be far more global. So two questions, and I will give both questions together. So then, you know, we can make better use of your time. One is actually around ease of doing business. So we have made great strides with a lot of support from leaders like you in actually getting better, particularly in the innovation sectors, on ease of doing business. How can we actually continue to make that progress now as it comes to manufacturing and make in India, which will really have a big impact also on our employment generation, livelihood footprint? So that's one question around ease of doing business. Second is around Atmanirbhar Bharat. We've heard, and all many of us have been part of conversations again around improving our technology footprint and capability, which will lead to better manufacturing again, but also bringing in very significant global players to enhance our presence in the global supply chains. So two pieces, ease of doing business, how do we use innovation, technology, digitization to actually improve on that, and second, Atmanirbhar Bharat.
Both are extremely relevant, Ms. Bansal. And undoubtedly, we cannot rest on the laurels of being ranked 62 or on the ease of doing business, but we have a long way to go to be amongst the top 25, as the Honorable Prime Minister would like us to be. Incidentally, the top 40 countries in UODB all have a per capita income above $30,000. And we are fighting against that kind of prosperous economies when we are trying to wedge our way in, but we are committed to doing. And we've just had a round of discussions with the World Bank officials. You'll also appreciate that ease of doing business is a comparative ranking, like a percentile. So while we'll improve, the other countries are also continuously improving. So you have to keep pace with their further improvement. But I assure you, the government is seized of it at every level. As recently as 3 days back, we had a very high level group of ministers working on arbitration, what we can do to make enforcement of contracts better. How can we promote India as an international arbitration center and maybe give Singapore and London a run for their money? Make it faster to resolve disputes in India. That's one of the areas where we are very lowly ranked in the ease of doing business. Similarly, as I said, I need your help. What can we do to make a true single window? But Sudhir Bhai will have to help me to make sure that the leakages are not allowed in that single window. Because unfortunately, you all know, and I also know, the moment you leave something, we have... I'm also a chartered accountant, so I can take a punt on chartered accountants. We have 10 smart, super alec chartered accountants telling you how you can break the law. You may bring in car, you may do anything, but we'll have enough and more advisors to tell us that, yeah, but the letter of the law says like this, just stick to that and you're okay. And I'm struggling with e-commerce companies who may be fitting into the letter of the law, but very often are breaking every spirit of the law in their operations. And I'm at pains trying to get them to understand that, look, law is not just that you can't, you know, do X. Please understand the meaning why you can't do X. So I think it's something where you will, as stakeholders, have to help us, but we stand committed. We would love to leave everything for self-regulation. We would love to allow you to regulate yourselves, like so many bodies. There are many industry bodies. Some are doing a damn good job. And there I can say the Chartered Accountants Institute is doing a very good job. Reasonably, it's a role model institute. But we have other professional bodies who do a very bad job. And then government has to interfere into that. I won't take any specific names here. So what I'm only trying to say is that we would love to do more and more self-regulation. But the sad part is we don't come up to the expectations of the nation. And then you have 10 cases which break the law. And then regulators get super active, bring in 10 new regulations to stop that leakage or stop that misuse, and we'll end up killing ease of doing business. So I think it'll have to be a collective effort. Both of us will, all of us, industry and government, will have to work together on that. Undoubtedly, to engage with the rest of the world, to truly make India Atmanirbhar, we will have to engage with the rest of the world. We'll need better technologies. We'll need more productivity. I have National Productivity Council before under me. Why don't all of you take the cudgels? Help me improve that. I have the Footwear Design Institute. Footwear has a potential to be at least a 5 lakh crore industry in India. 5 lakh crore minimum. It can provide jobs to maybe 30, 40 lakh, 50 lakh people. Maybe a crore of people. I don't know. But governments can't do it best. But if you join hands with us, yesterday I called up Noel Tata, our own Mumbaikar again. He's, I think, heading the Footwear Institute. He was so happy. He said, I'd love to do it if you're willing to give me a free hand. And he's promised to really get the cudgels of Footwear Design and Development Institute and take it to the next level. You pick up some of these ideas, pick up some of the sectors. Why doesn't Bombay Chamber come up with 4 sectors? And tell us, okay, these 4 we'll do all, we'll flesh it to the minutest detail, and we'll become world dominant in these 4 sectors. Then talk to the government what we can do to help. So let's work as partners, as I said. Let's bring the best from the world to India. We are not against imports. We want India to be also self-reliant, but also bring in the best. We want the best of AI to come in, best of robotics to come in. Data analytics to come. Why can't our startup ecosystem be Indian owned also? Why does every unicorn have to sell out? Where are all our industry captains when it comes to investing in our Indian startups? Can Bombay Chamber get all the piramals of the world and, sorry, Bhabhi, please don't mind, to put in a pool of capital and support our Indian startups? So let's all work together in that spirit of oneness. I have the confidence that we can be a world dominant power given the strength of our youngsters. All our young boys and girls, they are charged. They have all the ability in the world. We can do better than NASA can do. Look at our very own ISRO. Look at the achievements in space technology. Now we've opened it for the rest of the world. I was seeing Mr. Sivam's interview the other day on TV. It literally brings tears to your eyes. The great work ISRO has done. We can do that in every sector. We have to decide, the captains of India and Indian industry. You make up your mind. We are standing right with you, shoulder to shoulder. You take, as the Honorable Prime Minister says, you take 2 steps. He promises to take 4 steps. But we'll make sure India meets the aspirations of 130 crore Indians. We can beat anybody in the world, once you all make up your mind and we all work as one, as partners. Thank you.
Thank you so much for indulging us with a couple of questions, and even more energized now to hear about technology and the power of youth. And as someone who actually was a young engineer trainee at ISRO, I am so proud that you mentioned ISRO here as a global standard. Thank you.
Good. Thank you for your work. And thank you, everybody. It was really a pleasure meeting all of you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. May I now request Mr. Sudhir Kapadia, incoming president, Bombay Chamber, partner and tax leader, Ernst & Young LLP, to deliver his mission statement.
Thank you, Shruti. Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. Piyush Goyal, Honorable guest of honor, Ms. Dr. Swati Piramal, past presidents of the chamber, Partha, my esteemed colleagues in the chamber and industry, a warm welcome to you all once again. It is a singular honor and privilege to gain the trust and confidence of the members of this venerated institution in our beloved city to lead its efforts in this continuous and timeless journey right from its inception in 1836. Indeed, the original mission of Bombay Chamber duly embedded promotion of the common good, something which the minister spoke about on more than one occasion, and simplification and facilitation of business practices, which served as a watchdog for industry, and most importantly, an impartial intermediary, and these are the words from the original mission way back, between government and the Indian commercial community. Again, rings a bell with a lot of the messages we heard from the minister. As Mr. Parthasarathy so eloquently narrated, the four pillars of the chamber's current mission have set us on a renewed path aligned to current concerns and priorities of the nation and the city. Whilst the minister spoke about the Prime Minister's messages, it is also pertinent to recall actually the 10 pillars of India Vision 2030, which Mr. Piyush Goyal outlined as the then interim finance minister in his budget of 2019, befitting a potential $10 trillion Indian economy. Now, interestingly, those pillars encompass the dream of a sustainable and inclusive economic and personal growth for the citizens of our country, empowered by digital infrastructure and facilitated by a proactive, and these are in the 10 pillars, facilitated by a proactive and responsible government bureaucracy. So at least those pillars, I think, captures whatever we as business would like any responsive government to do. In fact, I thought he would mention it, but we should all just take note of this fact that the minister had just announced 100% electrification of Indian railways by 2030, which will make it the largest in the world with 120,000 tracks across India with net zero emissions. A very, very ambitious and a commendable ambition, no doubt. So as we can see, the chamber's mission encompassing the four pillars which Partha spoke about earlier are indeed very timely, very relevant, and well aligned to the priorities outlined in this India Vision 2030. It will therefore be my personal endeavor in the coming year, along with my very able and esteemed colleagues in the chamber, to continue to give shape and effectively contribute to the city and the nation alike. And in particular, it is my personal belief, and I think something again the minister spoke about, I would like to emphasize that independent institutions like the Bombay Chamber, I personally believe we will play a much bigger role in being this impartial intermediary based on world-class research, bringing the experts across the world in the country together, present analysis which informs the government, which informs business as well, and provides a point of view with which we can forge ahead on each of these initiatives and priorities. I think time has come where we just don't make representations, but we back it up with, as I said, globally benchmarked research with points of view all across. And I would also add the time has come where we present all dimensions to the government of the day to help them take the right decision for the country. Because sometimes one view or what seemed like a unilateral view coming from the bureaucracy or the government, or indeed a unilateral view coming from industry, may not be the only view. So this is, I think, the key priorities as far as the chamber's mission going forward is concerned, which with the help of support from all of you, I hope that we will be able to carry through. We spoke about Atmanirbhar, and I'll just end with one thought here. Minister spoke about it. We had certain questions as well. There has been some amount of, I would say, difficulties in understanding what it encompasses. I believe we are indeed at the cusp of a bold and confident journey towards a new India as outlined by the Honorable Prime Minister, with a renewed sense of purpose and determination to be self-reliant, what I would call in the strategic areas of national interest, but remain firmly open to the global ecosystem. And I'm glad the minister in his address today accentuated this, emphasized this loud and clear. Here, I would just like to end with the time-tested words of Mahatma Gandhi. And he had said about a century ago, "I do not want my house to be walled on all sides and my windows to be stuffed. I want the cultures of all lands to be blown about my house as freely as possible. But I refuse to be blown off my feet by any." As always, the Mahatma's advice is as relevant today for all institutions in our great nation, including the Bombay Chamber, as it was nearly a century ago when he wrote this. We at Bombay Chamber enthusiastically and energetically look forward to playing a small, albeit significant role in our collective national endeavors to realize India's Vision 2030 and the Atmanirbhar philosophy which the Honorable Prime Minister has outlined. Thank you very much. Look forward to your support, and back to you, Shruti.
Thank you, sir. Before our esteemed guest of honor, Dr. Swati Piramal, addresses the august audience, I am privileged to briefly introduce her. Dr. Swati Piramal, Vice Chairperson, Piramal Group. We are pleased to welcome Padma Shri awardee. Dr. Swati Piramal is Vice Chairperson, Piramal Group, a global business conglomerate with diverse interests in pharma, financial services, healthcare information management, real estate, and glass packaging. She is amongst India's leading scientists and industrialists whose contributions in innovations, new medicines, and public health services have touched many lives. Dr. Swati Piramal holds a master's degree in public health from the Harvard School of Public Health and a medical degree, MBBS, from Mumbai University. As the director of Piramal Foundation, the philanthropic arm of Piramal Group, Dr. Piramal is deeply involved in creating innovative solutions and establishing avenues that promote primary healthcare in rural India through Health Management and Research Institute, a mobile health service, women's empowerment projects, and enabling transformation of India's education system across public schools to unlock the potential of the young leaders of tomorrow through the Piramal Gandhi Fellowship Program. Dr. Piramal founded the Gopi Krishna Piramal Memorial Hospital in Mumbai and was instrumental in launching several pan-India public health campaigns against chronic disease, osteoporosis, malaria, TB, epilepsy, and polio. The hospital's first of its kind sports medicine center was dedicated to the treatment of arthritis in disabled children and the elderly, as well as sports injuries. She started Osteop India, a prevention of osteoporosis program and a field detection center for the detection of diabetes and epilepsy. Dr. Piramal has also authored a book on nutrition for patients with kidney disease. Through various capacities, Dr. Piramal has championed the cause of women leadership. She has served as the first women president of India's Apex Chamber of Commerce, ASSOCHAM, in 90 years. Dr. Piramal has served on the Scientific Advisory Council and the Council of Trade of the Prime Minister of India. Dr. Piramal is the Dean's Advisor to Harvard Business School and Public Health. She serves on the boards of several healthcare, financial services, manufacturing, and service companies, as well as on the boards of Indian and international academic institutions such as IIT Bombay, Harvard School of Public Health, and the Harvard Business School. May I now request Dr. Swati Piramal to address us on rebooting the economy after the pandemic.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you.
Can I just do a screen share, please? Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me to speak today. I want to tell you, jump straight into what I was trying to say today to reboot the economy after COVID, that in 1918, the Spanish flu, if you look at these pictures, is very similar to what's happening today. There were masks, there were quarantine, there was work at home, and even there were respirators. So for a century, our response to pandemics has not changed. But today, India is rebooting again. If you remember during the terrorist attack that we had in Mumbai City, the questions were the same. What were the results? What were the answers? And everybody was asking, how did this happen? And would we be able to recover? But today, that is a distant memory, and we hope that that will be true of COVID soon. We all, today the minister talked about Amitabh Bachchan. In this case, I think the enemy is invisible, and usko pakadna mushkil hai. And that is the real essence of the pandemic. If you look at this chart, on the left of this graph, it shows that the great transmission is happening when a patient doesn't have any symptoms. So how do you know that he's transmitting the virus or he's not transmitting the virus? Today morning's news was an example. They said Abhishek Bachchan went to a dubbing studio with just one other person or something like that. And you're not to know whether the virus is sitting on a surface over there. And actually after you get the symptoms, the transmission is lower. India's mortality rate, as the minister mentioned, is much lower, though our numbers are steeply climbing higher. I think the real differentiator is the leadership. And if we have good leadership, how Kerala contained COVID in 100 days, and yet we find many public health institutions not even, the posts are vacant in medical education or in public health departments, which are so critical in this crisis. Angela Merkel, for example, is one of the few women leaders who has lowered the transmission by sheer good management, playing to Germany's strengths of equipment and really being, maybe as they say, doomed to lead, but she's leading the world in Germany of how the response can be better with good leadership. My colleague at the Harvard School of Public Health, Dr. Lipsitch, who's one of the best known epidemiologists, said it's going to be like waves, not really just one big curve coming down. And there'll be peaks and valleys, and then there'll be waves in the fall in the US or in cold weather in parts of North India. And so we are not going to see the end of it very quickly. We're going to go on maybe for a few years. So then, what is the regimen for reopening? One example is that Atul Gawande is a very famous surgeon. He worked with 75,000 doctors in Mass Brigham, which is a hospital in Boston. And he said there's a five-part strategy. There are four pillars: a hygiene, distancing, screening, and masks. But the fifth element is very important, and that is culture. And the transmission rate for all these doctors has been extremely low. And he's the author of the book Checklist, and how do you do a checklist in this five-part public health plan. It is a fundamental and moral imperative, and I just want to briefly go through that. So the hygiene, screening, distancing, mask, culture, we've all heard about it. But if you skip one, the treatment won't work. It's like a cocktail, and you have to do it together. We need to understand their strengths and limitations if we want to reboot the economy. We know that now the symptoms are not just fever, sinus pain, and cough, or an altered sense of smell. There's a much wider array of symptoms that you can see every day. Start with hygiene. When you wash hands, and we've heard about it, increase in sales of soaps and things, but frequency makes a big difference. If you wash your hands 10 times a day, the frequency is down by 90% or so. If you do it 5 times a day, it's 45%. And if you do it every time you meet 3 people or more, then you will have a very, very low transmission. So a group environment is something where you could wash your hands before and after. So simple to do. Social distancing, we've heard everybody saying, should it be 3 feet or 6 feet? And the right now, the science is saying it's about 6 feet. It is now even transmitting in air through ventilators. So we have to be even more careful than ever before. Auditoriums and closed spaces, you know, there was a choir in Washington. They were singing loudly, and God knows whether that happened yesterday in the dubbing studio, where you were singing or speaking loudly, and that transmits the virus. A mask, there is an overwhelming evidence of the benefit of mandatory masks. Luckily, in our country, we are all in one party thinking that masks is important. In the US, there is a divide between the Republicans and the Democrats on whether masks are effective. Today's picture with Donald Trump wearing the mask for the first time, I thought is riveting, because masks now, there is really good scientific evidence saying that masks are important. N95 masks are useful for the healthcare community and not really for every person. So we all started looking like monkeys, but really masks are very vital. Culture is arguably the most difficult pillar of this new combination therapy. People tend to focus on two desires, safety and freedom. Keep me safe and leave me alone. My staff at home, when I'm not looking, will pull down their mask, keep it below their nose and do their work. Even when they're sweeping the floor, having a plastic thing will stop aerosols, will be pushed up. So how do you train people about culture and doing it all the time? Training people at work, at home, a culture and changing behavior is perhaps the most important thing. I believe that drug treatments are going to come faster than the vaccine, as there are 1,800 clinical trials around the world, and each one is trying to focus on different parts of the virus, sometimes killing it, sometimes treating the cytokine storm that you can see in this picture. That's what really kills the patient, and many, many drugs, including some of my own, are trying to beat this real piece in the puzzle. WHO did a very quick study on dexamethasone. It welcomes the preliminary results in the UK. You know that in the United Kingdom, in 1 month, they could recruit 5,000 patients. That was the fastest clinical trial I've ever seen. So this is what's happening. Scientists are collaborating, governments are working, and we are getting fast new drug approvals. 3 were approved in the last week, 1 this morning. And so it's just going on very quickly that the regulators are acting. So the 5 weapons of Wuhan were social distancing, contact tracing, testing, isolation, and treatment. Remember that these began a century ago. So we know what to do. The question is, how do you implement it? We also know that this is not the first disease, which is called a zoonosis, that it jumped from animals to humans. We know that there are 100 diseases. 2 examples recently are swine flu and bird flu. 1 came from pigs, 1 came from birds. So that is a zoonosis. What we have to predict it, and we have to survive. That is going to be the new science. A mental health crisis have been really the telling feature of COVID in our country, I guess everywhere in the world. And the real, I would say the burden on young people, especially even school children, is quite a lot. What are the lessons of history? Should we have a democracy, or is a dictatorship better, just enforcing all the rules? It is proved, that democracy is a much better way of transmitting information quickly to public and getting communication sorted. The president of Harvard, my colleague at the Board of Overseers, said there are 4 crises: health crisis, a moral crisis of disparity of availability of treatment by gender, by race, by poverty, a financial crisis, and a leadership crisis. And for the first time, the world is experiencing all 4 together. And that, I think, prompts innovation, the 5th pillar that the minister mentioned. There are innovations in everything. We have a pop-up hospital, a cardboard bed like this, which can be made into 200 beds, you know, inside a week. And so urban architecture, you know, just all these ventilators of air conditioning, filters, UV systems, all improving to help us fight the virus. There are new ways of working. Over the summer, my mother wanted to make pickles and she couldn't because of the lockdown. And here on the left is a picture of my cooks in PPEs, and then they made the pickle using mangoes, so she didn't lose her pickle. So I think this will be a new way of working in life. India has always underinvested in healthcare. At the time of independence, only 8% of the healthcare was private, the rest was public. Today, it is exactly the opposite. 75% is private and only 25% is public. If you lock down the private healthcare, obviously the public healthcare is going to be overloaded. There aren't enough beds, or there's difficulty getting a bed and things like that, which has been seen across cities in India. So if you lock it down, the major part of it, you will have this queue in the service. And I actually think that by releasing the lockdown, we will unlock the private healthcare. In Dharavi, just to prove my point, there's an army of GPs which helped Dharavi to beat COVID. Did this article mention the government or the BMC or other regulators? It was this private army of doctor entrepreneurs who opened up their clinics and really worked on the ground, knowing each of their patients really well. And therefore, this trend has been tipped. And so it is seen in other places as well. So, you know, just the lack of travel has really improved the skies, improved the train traffic, as the minister said, that you reach faster than ever before. So we must make our promises to COVID, be part of this appropriate behaviors. We don't want to be like the chicken who's cooked. We don't want to be in that position. And so we have to make 15 promises to ourselves, to our colleagues, to people at work. People don't wear masks when they feel they have a family member. People don't wear masks at work because you have a friend. People don't wear masks with a neighbor. And that is where we are really getting, you know, COVID very easily transmitted by these kind of behaviors. And so living in this lockdown position, we all went, you know, as the COVID virus is saying, I'm waiting for the end of the lockdown, me too, that this is going to be the big mountain to climb. You've seen the movie Sound of Music and everybody's climb every mountain. I think opening the lockdown, getting all this through and getting the doctor entrepreneurs to work, getting appropriate behaviors is going to be the key to really dealing with it. There's a talk about Chini Kam Karo, but we know that most of our products, especially medicines, the APIs for many, many years come from China. We have been doing price control for far too long. When we cut the prices so much that Indian manufacturers can't make the drug. We used to be, my own company used to be the primary manufacturer of vitamin A. I remember going to the then minister and saying that if you cut it so much that we can't make it, everything will go to China. He said, no, price control for us is very important. So now we are first time, even minister said, that we are realizing that we can't do that and we have to build our own infrastructure. So pandemic proofing the planet, I think is going to be a new business perhaps, a new way, a new place of innovation, predicting the surviving and all that. It's going to be a completely new normal. One of the things that Indian innovation, I just want to give one example. Somebody invented a UV light, which is mobile, and it goes from room to room in your home or office. Because we know that the bacteria lies down on you know, surfaces, and they invented this mobile unit. I was quite impressed with the idea, but you can't have a human there, so they have a long cord, and you put it into the room 5 minutes and the room is sanitized. So I think Indians are very good at innovation and they will continue to invent new things like this. Now, of course, we have to be very careful that we don't use sanitizers in the wrong places. This was a fire caused in a car in a Mumbai building. One of my beliefs is that there will be lower transmission after lockdown is over. Why is that? Because as I mentioned, you will unlock all the 75% of private healthcare who are actually sitting at home because there are no patients in their clinics. And this will, as many cities have seen, have really lowered the transmission. Now, it is not true in those states of America like Arizona, where they didn't allow masks to be worn. It is, remember the five cocktail drugs that I said that they have to be done together. You miss one and it won't work. And so this chart is actually for people who actually did everything correctly and gave them something to smile about. To end, I just want to say what the Piramal Foundation, of which I'm the director, did in the lockdown, which was again innovative and using no touch processes. We work in health, education and water. And one of the big things that we did in the first 3 weeks or so to make sure that thousands of people were fed. It is part of Indian culture, very strong part of Indian philosophy. And then we did an outreach contact tracing for people helping the government in distant areas like Assam, Nagaland, where we know health facilities are very poor. And then even in tribal areas to get children and mothers safely to deliver their children and have very low infant and maternal mortality. One of the things that I'm most proud of is a 35,000 volunteer program, which is protecting Nani, Nana, Dadi, Dada, older people in the 100 aspirational districts, the most backward, the most poor districts, it's all being run by young people. They're doing, you know, calls and then calling grandparents, telling them where the facilities are and what to do to protect themselves. And so this is something which anybody can do. All young people can come in and really do and make a difference and really apply every knowledge we have. One of the things that really is the flip side of the good parts that Minister said that, you know, I'm being more efficient, I'm inside my office, I'm doing more, we are all sitting at home. But I think the loss of education of a girl child is the most heartbreaking part of COVID, where children will not go to school. And how can we make sure that using technology, we are able to make sure that the girl child is not lost to education. And therefore, with these methods, aspirational districts are faring very well in containing the infection, despite lack of medical facilities. In water, we are cleaning nearly 2 crore liters of water because we know that water is very helpful in preventing infectious disease. So I really want to wait for the day when Amir Khan again says, all is well, all is well. And there's a U-shaped curve, you know, like this U with a doctor pulling reins. And I wanted to give you a public health perspective. And the minister gave a very nice economic perspective. But we wanted to re-emphasize that public health really matters at this time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Take any questions. It's lunchtime and it's
quite Yeah. Ma'am, our senior vice president, Ms. Anjali Bansal, would ask the question. Anjali, please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much for such a excellent, again, I think very thoughtful, very insightful, and as always with you, very informative. You made us think about so many different things, and I'm struggling to kind of select questions here. But, you know, going from COVID, its response, your insight on this five-part plan, insights from the Harvard School of Public Health, the point around changing culture and habits as we live and we work, the fact that you believe that drugs will come before the vaccine, 1,800 clinical trials around the world, very encouraging also, and absolutely yeoman sort of inspirational work done by Piramal Foundation. I must say, I am personally particularly touched by the fact that you mentioned the risk to education of the girl child, because we cannot lose the momentum that has been so hard won on keeping our girls in school and promoting literacy and education of the girl children. So with that, let me jump into a couple of questions. One is actually around public health, as you mentioned, and public health infrastructure in India to some extent actually has not kept pace. For us to be an aspirational economy, ease of doing business, where is the access to good public health? So So in your view, what will it take for us to really take pride as a developed country, $10 trillion economy, as we are aiming to be on the economic front, to create this infrastructure for access to high quality public health? Is it a public-private partnership? Yeah. Where will the investment come from?
Yeah, Anjali, so Amitabh Kant was on another panel at Harvard with me, and when he said that we should invest 5% of GDP in public health and health, I almost jumped for joy. And most of my colleagues said, this is not just music, it's an orchestra. Because we haven't invested at all in public health. We didn't think it was important. And till now, we understand how much burden the public institutions have to take. And we can't unlock the private institutions. So how do you get this balance? And I actually think that it is investment in healthcare. In understanding its importance, doctors, Amitabh Bachchan said it so nicely in a little video. He said that, doctors should have respect. We were battling for violence against doctors. So we can't treat our frontline soldiers, people who are giving their lives for other patients and for their colleagues. I think we have to treat them well. We have to pay them. We have to make sure they have the proper equipment. We have to make sure they have the training and do everything that we can. Don't we train the Indian Army? We do. So, and don't we give them guns and uniforms and everything to climb the Siachen glacier? We do. So we have to do the same thing with doctors and medical personnel.
So what will it take to promote more investment? One is, of course, the government. How should industry play its role in investing, not just sort of in, I have a private equity type background as well. So PE finds healthcare and managed healthcare to be a good asset class. But that is not enough. That is still promoting only private health infrastructure. What is the role that industry, in your view, should play? Not could, but should play. It's actually creating large-scale public health infrastructure.
So I'll tell you my experiments with the Piramal Foundation, because we work in 12 states. We work across millions of people. And it's in public health on the ground. In Assam, I noticed that there's one area in Assam which has the maximum breast cancer in women. I couldn't figure that number. Why is it that in that, very serene atmosphere that so many women are suffering? And I started a mobile healthcare service to diagnose and treat patients. It has to be with public-private partnerships. If we want scale, if we want investment, and if we want impact, you have to work with government. And foundations like that work with government, and they use technology. Because we are good at using AI, we are good at doing pilot projects, and then we are good at ramping it up. So it has to be a public-private partnership. There's no other way to quickly get scale. You can't do it on your own. No one company can do on their own a billion people.
Absolutely. I think the point you've made around, if you want to create scaled impact, whether it is in education or healthcare, which actually is infrastructural for a country like ours. So it is the soft infrastructure. It is not enough to just do roads, ports, and bridges. But it is equally, if not more important, to create the education and health infrastructure. So absolutely, working with government in a constructive, positive way. Let me switch a little bit to the point you made around technology. And India is a great hub for technology. We have an extremely vibrant, robust startup ecosystem. I'm sure you see a lot from your perch on what is happening with the AI, ML, artificial intelligence, analytics, big data led health tech that is emerging, and what is the role that could actually play in partnering with large companies as well as with government in creating this affordable, accessible public health? The use of technology, innovation, startups.
So our foundation just signed an agreement with Rockefeller Foundation. They are the oldest public health institution in America, where they treated hookworm disease a century ago. But now they have moved to doing AI in public health. And I thought that was fascinating, that how can we use AI to look at, public health? Why is it very simply, can I analyze you know, the x-rays of thousands of women and just quickly detect where a person would be doing it one by one by one by one. This would just, in minutes, tell me where the problems are. So I think AI and machine learning are the tools of the future. And investing them in public health, I think, will make the biggest impact. And therefore, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Rockefeller Foundation, these are some of our partners where we use big data and artificial intelligence on the ground.
Excellent.
So we certainly look at Piramal Foundation as a role model for all the work that, you know, we do with NITI Aayog, for example, and really thriving public-private partnership. So thank you so much. I will turn over.
Anjali, just one quick comment there. The corporates for change. This is one thing where we can all come together with what we are doing, because all of us are doing good. If we can good to get together, that also should have a multiplier effect. So we look forward to your suggestion and help even in that regard. Thank you.
That's great. We have a specific to-do coming out of this. So
always with me.
always. Yeah. And there are multiple requests. If you could share your presentation, please. So I will quote. It's very educative. Is it possible to get a copy so we can share it with other people and spread awareness of how to sort of reduce the spread of COVID?
Sure. Before you go, I just want to say that, you know, there's a story of Hanuman jumping over to Lanka, and then he stopped on the mountain and to rest. And the mountain was done by the Lord of the Sea, Sagar. And that was done in gratitude of what Ram's grandfather or ancestor had done to have the sea form. And so today I agreed because of that gratitude. When I was president of ASSOCHAM, I had called on your then president and said, would you please support me in some of these changes that I want to do? One of them was having a lot more women. So, you know, they did support me in everything and all. You know, modern chamber should function. And I really came after a 10-year long wait to give gratitude for that. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We are grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. May I request Ms. Anjali Bansal, Senior Vice President, Bombay Chamber, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Shruti. So it is an immense privilege for me to propose this vote of thanks at the 184th AGM of Bombay Chamber. On behalf of Bombay Chamber and myself, I extend sincere thanks to our chief guest, Shri Piyush Goyal, Honorable Minister for Railways and Commerce and Industry, our guest of honor, Dr. Swati Piramal, Vice Chairman Piramal Group. Both of you took time out from extremely busy schedules and made it convenient to grace us and our occasion today. I will not do a recap and a summary of what you have said because I've done this before, but I particularly want to thank your indulgence in taking questions because that no one can be prepared for and giving us such inspiring responses. At Bombay Chamber, we believe in closely engaging and collaborating with the government and regulatory authorities in matters that require a healthy overlap of policy, administration, and entrepreneurial execution. We hope to continue working hand in hand with both the government and regulatory authorities to provide an impetus to industry growth in the economy, as well as making Mumbai a continued international hub for business and financial services. And now I want to extend my very heartfelt thanks, as well as from all our members and office bearers and secretariat in the Bombay Chamber, to Mr. Partha Sarthi. Partha, You have been such an amazing leader for us in the chamber through this year, which was a very unusual year. Many things unfolded which were unprecedented, unplanned, and you kept us engaged, you kept us motivated and moving forward. So this was a year of tremendous new initiatives and events, particularly the four pillars that you have outlined. Sudhir, I look forward to working very closely together with you. And thank you for your mission statement, which charts our path for the next year. You have articulated yours and the Chamber's priorities that are relevant in the current scenario and going forward, which go much beyond the narrow perspective of industry. I think we've all talked about how we really need to partner across, you know, whether it is industry, government, and civil society. So we look forward to doing that, and I assure you of my absolute full support through the coming year.
Thank you.
I also want to thank the board members, past presidents, members of the various expert committees, for all their contributions and continuing, and particularly for our past presidents. You know, it's a unique body, and I think it's a very, very unique institution, Bombay Chamber, where no one actually leaves. We don't let them leave. And same thing goes for you, Partha. We're not going anywhere. We will keep calling on you for your support. And the same thing goes for our past presidents. Thank you all for taking time from your busy schedule and joining us today. All the activities and achievements of the Chamber cannot be accomplished without the strong and consistent support of the Chamber Secretariat. I would like to really give heartfelt, profuse thanks to our past DG, our current Director General, Mr. Sandeep Khosla, and each and every member of the Secretariat for their commitment and absolutely zealous non-stop work.
Thank you.
Before I conclude my address and the AGM, I thank all our participants and attendees for joining us today. Thank you very much.